continuing our study on this, Linda Winkler's book, How to Live Right in a World So Wrong. And he's looking at Moses as an example. We started out last Sunday. We did the live stream last Sunday, so there may be some who are picking up with us today. And those who are members here who do not have a book and are live streaming and not able to assemble with us, if they'd like a copy of the book, just let us know. We'll make sure you try to get one of those. Reach out to us. We'll do that. We are on page 7 in our book, continuing this study. We talked about Moses did not go wrong because he never lost faith. So time ran out last. And I want to start by emphasizing again this concept of going wrong versus making a mistake. Those are two different terms we're looking at. Remember, this go wrong denotes an abandonment. The word we use in that is apostatize, to totally leave the faith. There's a difference in stumbling and, think about this. How many of you have ever fallen? Show of hands. But everyone in here still walks, right? You didn't quit walking when you stumbled and fell. Imagine what it would be like if everyone stopped walking the first time they said. That's the concept that we're looking at here in this spiritual application. We're going to stumble, trip, fall at times, but as long as we get up and keep walking, that's 1 John 1, verse 7. So this idea of how to live right in a world so wrong, we see the difficulties that are in this world around us, the problems in this world around us. We're going to look at Moses again and see how he helps us to think about how Romans 15, verse 4, what's the things written before time, written for our learning? Now, we know the context of that was referencing the Old Testament and the New Testament times. But even the New Testament itself was written before our time, wasn't it? So those things written before are written for our learning, that we in the church might have comfort and peace through those things, those examples set forth for us. And the beautiful thing about the Bible is this, too. The Bible doesn't record just the good. Can you imagine what it would be like if you were going to sit down and you were going to write a story of your life? Wouldn't you be more tempted to embellish, the good and kind of, that time I did this, I'm not pretty bad, right? Oh, no one knows that. But the Bible records the good, the bad, and the ugly, teaching us from those mistakes. Learn from those mistakes so we don't repeat them in our future. So Moses, on page 7, in the second part of this study, says Moses did not go wrong because he preferred the people of God. He didn't go wrong, stay in that wrong. He made mistakes, clearly, but he didn't stay in that wrong because he preferred the people of God. Back to Hebrews chapter 11. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 25. It says, Hebrews 11, verse 25. Oh, let's read 24 and 25. It says, by faith Moses, when he was come to years, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. He gave that up. Listen to this again in verse 25. Choosing. Now, I circle these words in mind. Choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season. Choosing with them. Those words that I circled in this verse in my Bible, I'm not telling you to circle them, but I want you to focus on those. Choosing. This was a choice that he made. You've heard this before, I know. I've said it before if you've listened to me teach and preach, but no doubt you've read this and you've heard preachers talk about this. Many of us have heard many sermons, many lessons from Hebrews 11. But I want you to process what he gave up. He chose not to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. What would that involve? Anyone?
He would have been,
that's number one, that's great, a place of authority. People like authority, don't they? Can you think of any other reason why anyone would want to be in a high office in this country than the fact that they like to be in charge? They got to like that, don't they? I can't imagine that. Authority. All right, what else?
Wealth.
Oh, boy, yeah. Who doesn't like having plenty of money? I don't know. I worked with in air conditioning, he said that we were talking one day. I said, I don't guess I'll ever be, as we define rich, clearly in this nation, we're rich people, but as we define rich, Bill Gates, I said, I don't guess I'll ever be rich. God knows I can't handle it, to which he said, he knows I can't handle it either. money is what? Literally the root of all kinds of evil is how it would be. That's a better translation of that verse, actually. The root of all kinds of evil. What is the love of money? Not money itself, the love of money. You heard that. So he had, it was power, it was wealth. What else? What was something that was common among monarchies in that day and age? And it didn't really happen to change a whole lot. What was something that a king would often force upon his subjects? Processing this was a hard one, isn't it? But you're going to have to agree with it. When you think about when you study lore of the kings and the Caesars and the Roman Empire and the pharaohs of Egypt, they wanted them to love them. To that authority and that wealth often would force them to try to show their love. And what was one of the big problems with the Caesars and the pharaohs? They made themselves out to be what? They made themselves out to be gods, deifying themselves. Domitian is a good example of that. And Caesar and Pharaoh, of course, clearly. But we're looking at, he chose rather to suffer this affliction with the people of God. He chose, he made a choice to suffer with who? The people of God, than to enjoy pleasures. He says in the book on page 7, why is it so important to watch man's associates? How would you answer that without reading the rest of the paragraph? Why is it so important for us to watch our associates, those with whom we associate? Number one reason. Influence. Great answer. Influence. Because of their influence on us, and then the influence we show to others when they see us with them. Right? Can you agree with that? Have to. It's common sense. But he mentions in the paragraph, at any age, because often we think about this influence, we think about this, we call it peer pressure, don't we? How are you ever going to get out of peer pressure? How are you going to ever avoid peer pressure? Anyone?
Stay at home?
Nope. Not having peers. A man in his upper 90s told me that once. He said, outlive all your peers. That's the only way you're going to not have peer pressure. Good luck with that. It's not going to happen, is it? Peer pressure isn't just for the young, is it? No, that's the point. Associations are important. And so the number one point that he goes to in this section, how he didn't go wrong because he preferred the people of God, says, this is at the bottom of page 7, we need to watch our associates since we become like those with whom we associate. So, Brother Winkler, that's kind of a bold statement, isn't it? You know, that's not always going to be the case, is it? Well, number one, Winkler didn't come up with that concept, he gives a reference underneath it. What is it? 1 Corinthians 15:33. What does it say? Be not deceived. Evil company, evil companionships, corrupt good manners or good morals. But he started with don't be deceived. This is why it's so important. That influence concept, we're going to keep seeing that over and over again. Those with whom you associate have an influence on you. An impact on you. And the more you're with them, the more you tend to be like them. As he's saying in 1 Corinthians 15:33. He references God's speed, he refers to this text this way. He says, do not be misled. Bad company ruins character. I like that. What is your character, really? When someone says, what's your character? Comes to mind. Isn't it really who you are? It's at least who you portray yourself to be. You project yourself to be this. We can lie. That's why he said, don't be deceived by this. Don't be misled. How are we going to be misled in our character? Because we're trying to make our character fit into this mold of what we see in those with whom we associate. If they like it, then I'm going to like it. Have you ever? It's hard for me to process this because of the way I like coffee. I do like coffee. But there was a time when it was more of an idea than it was actually an enjoyment. Because I saw mom and dad drinking coffee, you know? And I can remember one of the first times when I really started drinking coffee in, know he's not going to do.
Couldn't you?
You ever done something you didn't really want to do? Something you didn't really like just to impress somebody? And it didn't matter. That's the thing.
I think oftentimes he says don't be deceived as we go into these relationships with evil companions thinking that our influence can be strong enough to change them.
That's a great one, brother. And I do. And that's taking the high side of this. Not only negative and you and positive. God bless you for that. That's exactly right. If you didn't hear him, so a lot of people go into these, and I have to do this for audio and master purposes in recording. A lot of people go into these relationships thinking that their influence as a godly person, let's use that, a Christian godly person, I'm going to go into this relationship because I'm going to influence them. Can that happen?
Yes.
Does it happen? Yes. But the odds aren't good. We're going to talk about that a little bit more in this study. Don't be deceived in thinking. You remember what Paul said to the Corinthian church? Let him who thinks he stands, what?
Take heed.
What we do, if we're not careful, is underestimate our enemy. You're talking about the diabolical one who from the very beginning of time has been at this job. Deceiving mankind, right? Deceiving. But we're also talking about the diabolical one who was willing to stand face to face with Jesus himself and tempt him. Do you think he's really scared of you? Me?
Not at all.
He's scared of this, though. He's afraid of this, especially if this is in us. And we can overcome it. Yes, that's a great point, brother. But listen to these illustrations that he uses in the book to this effect. And some studies that we may have studied in the past, maybe haven't spent some time with in a while, but Genesis chapter 19, verses 30 through 38, he talks about what happened between the time Lot's daughters were born pure and innocent, and all children were born pure and innocent. What happened between the time that they were that way and they became mothers for incest? Got their father drunk and lay with him to have children with him. What was the influence? What was the impact on their lives that changed them from that innocence to that?
Sodom.
The wickedness of the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah. The vileness that was so wicked that God said, if you can find 10 righteous souls, I'll spare them. And if you can find 10 righteous souls, including Lot's house. Think about that. Or he goes on and gives another illustration. What about Peter going from, you're the Christ, the Son of the living God. I don't know exactly who God's foreknowledge and his omniscience and all the things that God is, and Jesus being God, of course. I don't know exactly what it would have been like when Peter, when he asked him, who do men say about some man and animal? Some say you're John the Baptist, some of the prophets. Who do you say that I am? You're the Christ, the Son of the living God. I know he says, blessed art thou, Simon, Bar-Jonah, Simon, the son of Jonah, for flesh and blood is not revealed. This is Matthew 16, starting verse 16. Flesh and blood is not revealed, this unto you, and my Father which is in heaven. Say, I also unto thee, thou Peter, upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell are not fell against him. We mentioned that earlier. So, I can kind of picture in my mind a flicker in Jesus' eye almost when Peter made that statement. Can you? I'm proud of you. Moment. That's it. That's exactly right. Lord, you're the Christ, the Son of the living God. Or about the time when, Lord, to whom shall we go? Will you too go away? Lord, to whom? John chapter 6, right? Lord, to whom shall we go? Thou hast the words of eternal life. Can you imagine a smile maybe coming to Jesus' face? And proud of you, that's good job. But what do we know also about Peter? What else did he say?
I don't know the man.
What was the difference in Peter saying, you're the Christ, than Peter saying, Lord, to whom shall we go? And saying, I don't know the man.
Who he was with.
Absolutely. Who he was with. He was warming himself by the wrong fire, wasn't he? You heard that terminology used before? That's in Matthew chapter 15, verses 66 to 72. The association. was with, he lost sight of reality. You can sit in a pew right now and not have a total clue what reality is. Sitting in a church building, opening God's Word, bowing your head and praying, singing songs, and not have a clue about the reality. You could be saying the exact same thing Peter said, I don't know, man. Not even realizing you're doing it. Don't be deceived. Don't be deceived. Evil communication is corrupt, good morals, good manners. Number two, he says, we need to watch our associates, since we will be judged by those with whom we associate. We will be judged by those with whom we associate. You remember in our studies in John on Wednesday nights, we're in the prayer of Jesus in John chapter 17, and Jesus prayed for his disciples specifically. He prayed for his own glorification first. But he prayed for his disciples, his closest friends next, and he said to the Father not to take them out of the world, right? I pray that you don't take them out of the world, but you keep them from the evil one. Keep them from evil. What does that mean? What was Jesus praying for?
That God had given them the strength to avoid situations like
that. Definitely, that's part of God giving them the strength to avoid the temptations of the evil. Yes, but how does that, what does that statement mean in reference to our study at hand? What was Jesus praying for?
For them to influence other people.
Absolutely. Exactly. He was praying for their influence on the world. Because he's going to pray later on for those who would believe on their word. Who would believe after them, those who would believe because of their teaching, their influence, exactly. He was praying, the world needs, do you ever stop and think that the world needs you to be an influence for Christ? That God's counting on us. We need to watch our associates because we will be judged by those with whom we associate. Amos 3:3, can two walk together except they be agreed? When you heard that verse, how often are we using that verse? Well, what's the reference that we're trying to make with that, or the point that we're trying to make when we emphasize, can two walk together except they be agreed? Anyone? Anyway. Character.
Marriage.
We've got a lot of character in marriage. Marriage. That's one. Can two walk together except they be agreed? Often, isn't it the case that often we're using that verse to state that we can't really be walking with Jesus unless we agree with Jesus and his word? We can't really be children of God, Christians, Christ-like, if we're not following, if we're not agreeing with what he says. Doesn't that fit too? But have you ever considered that verse in this way? If all of my closest friends are ungodly, worldly people, do I agree with them? Yeah, check or not, have you thought about it that way? Maybe you're deceived in thinking you're going to be a good influence on them. But maybe we need to step back and remember Amos 3, can two walk together except they be agreed. If I'm walking with them, and that's what I'm spending the bulk of my time with, and that's the influence that's around me all the time, is God saying you agree with me? Well, careful. You could be deceived. You could be deceived. See, the closer we get in relationships, the more we try to dismiss the negativity of the sin that's in those relationships. The more we try to whitewash it, it's, oh, I know that he's a denominational preacher. He's a good guy. I know he preaches error and talks about some plan of salvation that's foreign from the Word of God, or preaches that once you're saved, you're always saved. He preaches in heaven every Sunday and every Wednesday. He's a good guy. And he's a relative. I've got those. I've got those too. He said there's a Spanish proverb that says, tell me with whom you associate, and I will tell you who you are. What are the odds of me getting busted in some? maybe some drug cartel out here that's got a bunch of figures. What's the odds of them doing a bust on some gang and I'm going to get busted with it? What's the odds of that?
Be pretty slim.
Be very slim, brother. Why?
You don't do that, huh?
Because I don't associate with them. What if the government changed the next time they're going to start putting Christians in prison for doing what we're doing right now? What's the odds of me going to jail for that?
You're out of here.
For many Christians, it's going to be slim. Isn't it? They're not going to show up. It's hard enough to show up when you have freedom to do it. Right? I'm not trying to be trite or offensive in this. Just, we need to step back and realize that we're dealing with things that are of eternal weight and force. What's the most valuable thing that you have?
Your soul.
The one thing that we often spend the least amount of energy and effort to take care of. It's the most valuable thing that we have. It's our souls. What shall I give in exchange for a soul? Tell me with whom you associate, and I will tell you who you are. He said, why is this important? Such reflects upon your reputation and correspondingly upon your influence, and we must guard our influence with jealous vigilance. When Jesus said, to see me is to see the Father, what was that for? They were so unified. You can know there was. You reference marriage probably, we're going to come to that in the fourth point in this book. The longer a couple stay together, there's a lot of things that you, with some couples, you see this more so than others, but they're so one. You don't see one without the other. Sometimes they even dress alike. My great uncle and my great aunt, they used to always, on Sundays, they would like coordinate. I'm all picking, but I love to see the Dilworths. You know, y'all compliment each other. It's beautiful. It shows that community. So it's a wonderful thing. What about my life tells you or points you to Jesus? What about your life points anyone to Jesus? I'm not talking about just on Sunday when we come together on Wednesday night at Bible classes. I'm talking about when you go to work tomorrow, or when you go to the office and you vote, or when you go to the store and you buy your groceries, or I need to work on my own. Anyway, when you do whatever you do, what about your life says Jesus? That's what he's talking about, I guess. Tell me with whom you associate, and I'll tell you who you are. Listen to number three. He says we need to watch our associates since our lives become enmeshed, intertwined, and intermingled with those with whom we associate. This is the point we were talking about earlier. We take on some of those characteristics. There's a phrase, guilt by association. You ever heard that one? There have been people who have been taken to jail and put in jail because they were in a vehicle with people who were doing wrong. They themselves may not have done that that was wrong. There have been people before that, I know a situation that happened years ago in Mobile where the city, it was county, the county police came and took everyone at that house to jail because there was alcohol in a dry county. Took every one of them to jail. Though they didn't, not everyone had alcohol. But if you were there, it was guilt by association. Oh, they didn't. Of course, they didn't get charged. They had to let them go. But still, they got carried there that night. Because they were in the wrong place. Shouldn't have been in the first place. Guilt by association. See, the more we're with them, the more we get enmeshed, intertwined, or intermingled. Those whom we associate. We're getting a long time. Let's go ahead and go to number four. We need to watch our associates, since from them our marital companions for life will be chosen. He mentions that this is the tenor of the scripture. There's an emphasis in the scripture that goes to marrying within the faith. That should be a priority. listen to how he words it here, because I won't mislead anybody. He says that the tenor of the Holy Scriptures emphasizes that a child of God ought to marry a child of God. And he references 1 Corinthians 9:5, and Paul said that he exercised this right to marry whom he would marry, a believer, verse 5 of chapter 9. Marie references Abraham, Genesis 24, verse 3. Make an oath. Promise me you're not going to find a wife for Isaac from the Canaanites or from the Hittites, the Perizzites, and the Jebusites, or any other. Make sure it's one of God's people. Why is that important? And you know what happens when you start talking about this as a preacher? What often happens? Anyone? Well, I know so-and-so married. I give you five couples that were married non-believers and they converted their spouses. It's wonderful. But listen to this. This is from a while back. I understand this. This is from a while back. But he quotes, this happened in Fort Worth, Texas. He says, they did a study of our young people, this is in the church, as concerns whom they married. The results were astonishing. He said, during the four-year period studied, there were 64 graduates. 10 of these married outside the church. 9 became unfaithful. 5 married unfaithful members. 4 of them became unfaithful. 21 married faithful Christians. All of them remained faithful. Such Christ's followers. What? 21 married faithful Christians. All of them in that study maintain faithfulness. What's it take? Well, it's not going to be me. Yeah, and that's what every alcoholic said too when they took the first drink too, right? It's not going to be me. I'm just having a good time. And they're an alcoholic. What's the most valuable thing we have? Well, how are we ever going to influence someone if we don't get in those relationships with those people who are not Christians? Okay, I understand. But if you as a faithful Christian don't set the standard up front that this is what matters most in my life, don't expect them to either. Is that fair? That's what he's saying. Why did God do this? Why did God say, don't intermarry with the Gentiles? Well, it was to keep the seed line pure for Jesus, right? That was the ultimate reason, but that wasn't the only reason. What did he tell Joshua and the children of Israel when they went into the promised land? Drive them out. Why? Because you have an example of King Solomon. He married all of those women from all of those different religions and different backgrounds. When he was old, they turned his heart from God. The wisest man, given wisdom from the divine prerogative of God, they turned his heart. They turned his heart. And so the final one was number 5, some deductions. He says, let us always be the best or the blessed man of Psalm 1. Not walk in the counsel of God, not stand in the path of sinners, not sit in the seat of the scornful. Psalm 1. Have your delight in the law of the Lord, in his law you meditate day and night, and be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that brings forth its seed, its fruit in its season, and what you do will not perish. He says, let us despise the vile and honor those who fear the Lord. Psalm 15, verse 4. And let us say with the psalmist, I am a companion. That's who I spend my time with. That's who I'm closest to. I am a companion with all who what? Fear you and keep your precepts. It's hard enough for me to keep myself faithful, isn't it? Isn't it hard enough for you to keep yourself faithful just by yourself to be faithful? It's just that much harder when someone's having to help you pull you away from God out here because of your relationships. We can be an influence for good, and he expects us to be an influence for good. Matthew chapter 5, salt, light, all those things. But don't be deceived. Satan's doing his job. Lord willing, we'll pick back up next Sunday with number 3. Moses did not go wrong because he realized sin's pleasures are short. Any comments or questions?
You know, I just looked in Galatians chapter 2, you know, where Peter and the Barnabas, you know, they got involved with stuff there.
Right. When Peter was... showing that prejudice, it affected Barnabas and others as well. Barnabas and some of